Today we are going to talk about what happens if a couple do get married and are still not, you know, happy with it. Either one is not happy or both are not happy. And because of that, a person can, you know, go to the depths of hell, even if other relationships and other aspects of that person's life are doing very well. An unhappy or disharmonious or conflicting marriage can pull a person down very badly. So that is where the role of the counselor comes in, to do marital counseling. Well, when we start off with marital counseling, there are two things I want you to understand very clearly. Number one, that you can do marriage counseling only if both come for counseling willingly. Otherwise, you can help your counselee. One partner has come to you, you can still help that partner. You can help that person as an individual, but you cannot actually help that person to improve the marital relationship. So as long as you make that clear, you can go ahead with that. Now, presuming that slowly somehow the other partner has also been convinced and is willing to come for counseling, now you have both the people available to you. When the people, both of them are coming to you, I personally believe, it's not necessary, but I personally believe that, talking to them individually, because it helps to get out a lot of things. There may be people who say that, I have no secrets from my spouse. We have differences, but there are no secrets. So it doesn't make a difference. Both of us can sit and talk to you. Normally what I tell them is, you may be comfortable together talking. I am comfortable talking to both of you alone. I will connect better, I will be able to focus better. So can I talk to A and B separately? Even if they come together, can I have to wait outside, I talk to A, then I call in B and A can go and sit outside like that. So I start off with that. The reason being that you inevitably get some input, some information which you would normally not have got. A lady may say that, you know, we have differences when my mother-in-law comes to visit and there are issues and this and that, and you know, she's very critical of me. Now, in the presence of the husband, she may not be willing to say that when he's not there, she does these slimy things. Because he may feel insulted, or he may not believe, or whatever it is. So some small thing may be there which she may not be able to freely open up. So that's why we start alone. When we start alone, what we do is, we work on these four pillars in the reverse direction. I first want to know from my counselee, are you committed to this relationship? If you have already given up on it, if you feel, no, I think it is over, I think there is no hope left, I don't think my spouse will change and that I will be happy, I actually stop and say, go and reflect. Why do you want to waste your time? Forget about my time. When you have decided that you don't want to, there is no future left in this relationship. So I try to spur them on and say, if you want to give it a go, if you want this counseling process to have some chance of success, I want you to start believing that you would like to make a commitment. At least till the counseling is going on. If it fails, you still have the right to separate or whatever it is. But right now, can I have that, you know, word from you, assurance from you that in the next few days or next few weeks, you will remain committed to actually improving the relationship. Once that is done, I work on the trust part of it. Do you trust or do you not trust? If there is trust, your chances of working with the couple improve. If there is no trust, generally what I do is to find out which are the areas in which you don't trust your spouse. What happens is that if, let's say, one spouse has cheated the other in money matters, hidden from the spouse and taken away the money from the joint account or spent it off on something or whatever it may be. Now, if B says, I have lost trust in my spouse because he or she did this, what I do is I make the person understand that if it is only in the area of money, you can always do something to safeguard your money. But do you trust the person for, let's say, not having affairs? Do you trust the person in not doing other bad things behind your back? Yeah, in those areas, he or she is trustworthy. So that's how I build back the trust. And then we move on to respect. Do you understand that men and women are built differently, not only physically but emotionally also? So you cannot expect your spouse who is of the opposite gender to have the same thinking and the same emotional pattern as you have. Similarly, for years and years of childhood, adolescence and part of adulthood, your partner has lived in his or her family where the environment, the condition, the ideology, the attitudes, the value system may have been completely different. So do you respect the fact that my spouse is different from me and I cannot expect my spouse to be my mirror image? I don't have to agree with the things that my spouse is doing, but do I at least respect that because my spouse is of the opposite gender or my spouse has come up in a different upbringing? My spouse will not be thinking the way I am, so I will respect that. And finally, we go on to improving the communication. The more the communication improves, the better are the chances, because that is part of that empowerment that we always talk about in counseling, that instead of solving the problem right now, we are trying to empower them so that in future, if they have differences or problems, they should be able to resolve it. And in a close relationship, particularly marital relationship, it is based entirely on how good the communication is. And communication is not just, you know, saying today Mangamma didn't come, or I think that Congress is better than BJP or all those type of things. Communication is being able to emote, to be able to express one's deepest feelings. Once that is done, you build up that level of communication, then you know that you are on the right track. And you can take things forward, including the fact that even if they don't come back to you for counseling, if they can keep building up their communication from time to time, they go ahead with the